Shalom, my friends from here in the Holy Land. I've been following all day the horrendous attack that took place in Las Vegas, and my prayers are with the families of those injured and those killed. Here in Israel, we know what terror is. Just earlier this week, I went to go visit the family of two soldiers who were killed, and I spoke to their family and gave them a gift, actually a grant, on behalf of Christians and Jews around the world who stand with them. And so I know what the face of terror looks like. I know what the face of tragedy looks like. So whatever you want to call this attack, just know that the people of Israel are with you. And it's traditional in Judaism, when something bad happens, when a tragedy strikes, when lives are lost, that we learn something in honor of those souls that are ascending up to heaven to sit with the king of the world, the master of the world, the creator of the world. And by us learning in their honor, it gives their soul an elevation. So I pray that our learning today will elevate the souls of those needlessly murdered today in Las Vegas. I was thinking, what's the right thing to speak about today? You know, so often when there's no words, the only words that are correct are the words of truth, the words of the Torah, the words of God. And so I want to speak to you about mourning. It's something that's always been so beautiful to me, that in Judaism we actually have laws pertaining to mourning. I remember when I was in high school, I had a friend and his father died, and it was so sad and shocking for him. And after the funeral, they had nothing else to do really, so they went out to dinner and they went out to a bar and they drank alcohol. And then he kind of felt very alone for the next few weeks. His friends didn't really want to reach out to him because they wanted to give him a space to heal, but he was feeling really alone. And it's something that always struck me so deep in my heart. In Judaism, what we have is a time of Shiva, which literally means mourning, or it comes from the word Sheva, which means seven. There are 7 days of creation. We learned that seven is a full cycle. And so after someone dies, their immediate family members, as you might have heard this term before, sit Shiva. What does it mean to sit Shiva? There are laws pertaining to this that come straight from the Torah. It means after the burial, for 7 days, the immediate family sit, not on comfortable chairs, but on the floor in the mourning. They tear their clothes in order to show that they're mourning. And they don't listen to music. There are all different customs and traditional laws that go along with it. But essentially what it is a house of mourning. They cover up all of the windows, all of the mirrors, so that they can't see themselves in the mirrors, because they don't want to look at physical, they don't want to look at how their appearance is. They're focusing only on mourning. The Torah says you have 7 days. This is the time that you mourn very intensely. And so the family members just sit. They don't listen to music, and it's a mitzvah, it's a positive commandment for all the people to come and visit them, what's called the Shiva house. And so friends come, family members come, people who knew maybe the one who passed away when they were younger, they come and visit the family and tell stories and share memories. Even strangers come. When I was at the Shiva house for the Israeli soldier who was killed earlier this week, there were strangers there just giving comfort to the family. When you go to pay a Shiva call, what it's called, when you go to the house of mourning for these first 7 days after an immediate family member dies, you're bringing comfort to the family. Now, this is so important because, first of all, for the mourners, so many people try to push it off and suppress their emotions and say, no, I'm okay, I'm functioning okay, and they try to go back to life and go back to work and right away, but then eventually it comes out later. What the Torah is saying is, no, you have to mourn. This is your time to mourn. Don't suppress your emotions. Don't suppress anything. Get it out. Mourn the loved one that you lost. And what it's saying to all the other people is, you should go and visit them. Even if you didn't know them so well, even if maybe you didn't know the family members who are still alive, but only the person who died, normally you wouldn't call a family member and say, hi, I'm so sorry for the person who died. It might feel a little bit uncomfortable. So what Judaism is saying is, no, It's a positive commandment. It's an open house where they're mourning, where you go and pay them comfort. You give them comfort. So we have 7 days of this intense mourning. And then we have a little bit where they come out of mourning a little bit. It's called the Shloshim. That means 30. So for the next 30 days, they're still in mourning, but it's a little bit less intense. They could start wearing clothes that aren't torn. They could look in the mirror again. They could go back to work. They're slowly, slowly getting back into life. But it's only after a full year of designating mourning, after an immediate family member dies, that the person goes back into the world. For an entire year, they are in what's called the year of mourning. They don't go to parties, they don't go to celebrations, there are all different things that they don't do and things that they do do. They go to synagogue and they say the Kaddish prayer. Kaddish literally means, comes from the word Kadosh, which means holiness. And so what they do is they go into synagogue and they declare God's holiness, that God is the God forever, despite the hardships that happen, despite maybe the person died from a tragedy we should never know. They're going into synagogue with the community, and first of all, it means that they're not staying isolated. When you have to go and say Kaddish 3 times a day, you're going out into the world and you're surrounded by community. That there are people that see how the mourner is doing, offer help, they're there for them. And after a year of saying Kaddish, of saying the mourner's prayer, do they go back to life. And so not only does faith, does Judaism tell them when to mourn, it also tells them when to come out of mourning. So often, did you ever know someone who mourned forever, who never stopped mourning? What Judaism is saying is you have 7 intense days after an immediate family member died to have intense mourning. Then you have 30 days that you're a little bit getting out of that intense mourning. Then you have a year that you're continuing your mourning, but you're moving on with life. After the year, you go back to your regular life. Does that mean that you forget the person who died? Of course not. But it's giving us a recipe for a healthy way to mourn. I pray that all of us will only have to mourn grandparents, great-grandparents, loved ones who reach 120 years of age. But it's very important, if you're Jewish, if you're not Jewish, to understand these two core concepts of faith. The Jewish tradition that for 2,000 years the Jews have been following. The first one is for the mourner. It's okay to mourn. It's okay to feel so sad and destroyed. But after a year, you have to move on with life. You could remember the person, you could memorialize the person, but you have to move on with life. And for the other side, it's for friends of the mourners, or even not friends of the mourners. Maybe it's someone you heard about in your community who's mourning that you never met before, that we have to go and give them support. We have to be there for each other. We have to support each other. As people of faith, we have to be there to lend each other a helping hand, a word of encouragement. And so I know there are 58 innocent souls who were murdered today in Las Vegas. Innocent. Murdered. We have to return our hand to them. If you know their family members, or even if you don't, but you live in the close vicinity to their family members, give them a phone call, go pay them a visit, write them a letter. Let them know that they're not alone. And join me in praying for all those that are injured. May they have a speedy, quick recovery, and may this world not know any more mourning. Let the world not know any more tragedy. Let us see the day where the lion dwells with the lamb, where we plow our sword into the ground, where we won't learn about war any longer, we will only know peace. May it be soon in our days.